Welcome to this episode of Chat with Chairs. We are delighted to have with us today Dr. Vidya Yerravadekar, who is the chairperson of the FICCI Higher Education Committee, and she is the Pro Vice Chancellor of the Symbiosis International University, Pune. Welcome, Dr. Vidya, to this Chat with Chair. For this year has been actually revolutionary or remarkable in terms of the initiative of the national education policy that was announced here. It was after many, many years that we have a comprehensive national education policy. So if I could begin with, if you could just share with us, how do you look at the National Education Policy 2020? And in view of the imperatives of the 21st century, and also if you can add a twist to the question, this was done at a time pre-COVID. So during COVID and post-COVID, does it make even more sense, or and does it comprehensively address the issues of access, equity, quality, and excellence?
Yes, so thank you, Dilip, for inviting me to have a chat with you. As you very rightly said, that the National Education Policy 2020, or more popularly known as the New Education Policy 2020, is something that is that we were all awaiting, and I think it's such a great welcome to have it in this, you know, being implemented in this new year. I think the year 2020 will be remembered for several things. First of all, of course, the COVID pandemic. And for us as academia, for Indian government to have rolled out the National Education Policy. It's almost 34 years since you know, the last education policy was rolled out. And I think there's been a sea change in what happened in the Indian higher education system over the last 34 years. And I think over the last decade, you still see you know, the whole change in our education system, not just at the higher education level, but even at the school level. And I think the National Education Policy has really captured all this very well. As you very rightly said, that yes, any education policy in India cannot but capture, you know, the challenges of equity, access, inclusion, which it has. But I think what it has given more focus is to, you know, kind of put India on the international map when it comes to education and academic delivery. And I say this because you very well know that internationalization of higher education is something that is very close to my heart. And therefore, with my several interactions with international academia, you know, they're quite excited about the Indian government rolling out this national education policy. In fact, I many a times in the webinars, I very jokingly tell them that, you know, y'all are discussing this education policy more than what we are discussing in India. Which also means that they, this education policy has looked at, you know, all these kind of global elements, because I think the bottom line is to create global citizens with very deep rooted Indian values. So a lot of importance has been given to, you know, the study of Indian culture, Indian heritage, etc. But, you know, the kind of bent of this policy is towards the impact of globalization on higher education. And therefore, when you look at this policy, I think the word multidisciplinary has, you know, been featured, I think, more than 100 times. And, you know, when we speak to Dr. Kasturi Rangan, the architect of this national education policy, he does say that, yes, I know we've overused that word, but we want to overemphasize, you know, that education needs to be multidisciplinary. And you've been associated with, you know, academia through your earlier appointments, and even now with, you know, with heading the FICCI. You very well know that, you know, undergraduate education has to be a liberal education. And I think when they talk about multidisciplinary education, that's the concept that they want to bring in. I think the other good thing that they've done is, I won't speak about all those statutory bodies and, you know, the regulatory bodies, but I would definitely like to speak on the kind of changes that they've really brought in. I think the biggest change that they've brought in is talking about a four-year undergraduate liberal program and liberal education. Because the multidisciplinary element will only come when you talk about liberal education or liberal arts education or whatever you call it. And for some time, we all thought that, is it now really getting under the American influence? Because till now, we were under the British influence. And now, is it tweaking towards that? But then again, they've mentioned about, you know, what the Indian history of education was all about. And it was liberal education. I mean, We all know that our whole education system and the basis and foundation of the Indian education system was to give and impart a very strong foundation of knowledge, you know, and that is what the focus is. So if you look at it from that perspective, yes, it is global and also local. And I think it is a very, very comprehensive policy.
So, you know, you mentioned, Dr. Vidya, about this whole thing about moving to a four-year undergraduate program and liberal and, you know, the multidisciplinary approach, etc. So if I had to look at this, you know, you talked about developing a system that has a flexible curricula, credit-based system, environmental education. Now, how seamlessly, and you know, you've been in this space and Symbiosis has been in the different aspects of the education space for many, many years, and you've seen it evolve over the years. In fact, your father, if I may say, Dr. Majumdar, is actually quite a legend in this space. But, you know, do you think that and how seamlessly would Indian universities and higher education institutions adapt to this, and how will you be able to, you know, integrate it? There was earlier a failed experiment of 4 years, if it was the FIUP, let's say, in Delhi University at all. But how do you think that the university system across the country is geared to actually adopt this and effectively execute it? And how does government or other organizations actually enable the execution of this going forward?
So this is a very good question. And I think we've implemented this at Symbiosis because, as you very rightly said, to execute liberal education is not very easy. I mean, first of all, the mindset of parents, where parents want their children to be very focused in certain disciplines. I mean, if I want my daughter to do medicine, then I would put my daughter into at least two years of very rigorous coaching and then ensure that she goes and does only medicine and gets skilled in all the various disciplines of the Faculty of Medicine. And so is the same with engineering or law or any professional program that you look at. But really, aren't we producing technocrats, or tunnel view kind of individuals? And I, for one, believe that undergraduate education should have a very strong foundation of values, of foundation of knowledge of different subjects, so that, you know, you actually create individuals who are good by character, and we help them shape their personalities with very strong value systems of ethics, integrity, etc. And that is what you should do at the undergraduate level. And the focus on any discipline should be really at postgraduate level. So if you look at the medical curriculum in American universities, it's not like ours. They have a whole pre-med curriculum, which is so multidisciplinary. And then they go on and lead the students on to actually doing medicine, which we do at our postgraduate level. So we started the Symbiosis School of Liberal Arts, I think, in 2011. I mean, we were the first ones to start. And let me inform you, Dilip, that we are the only organization or university to still roll out a 4 years liberal arts program. Because you know Dr. Muzumdar, you know, if he does something, he knows he does it right. And then he doesn't bend even if some minister or government tells him to, because he says that we've done enough and more research before we start a program. But once having started, we are committed to what we have decided to do. And I think a liberal arts program or an undergraduate program ideally should be a 4 years program, because you need that expanse of, delivery of knowledge, and you need those kind of years also, because you're just actually nurturing such young minds who have just completed their 17 years of school education, and then, you know, they join the college or the university. What you said is very right. It's going to be difficult for Indian universities to implement. It was difficult for us because I think first and foremost is faculty. I mean, faculty, as much as students and their parents also want specific kind of skill and very tunnel view education, is the same with faculty. How many of our faculty actually would be able to teach a liberal arts program? It's very difficult. So, I think we need to also kind of emphasize on the fact that we need a lot of faculty training and handholding if we have to really roll this this multidisciplinary program. This is one. Second is, I think you need to bring in a lot of structural changes. You know, when we talk about flexibility or when you talk about, the academic credit bank, I think they're very seriously working on that. It's a great thing to happen, but, you know, the implementation is going to be a challenge. So I think the University Grants Commission or whichever body that the ministry really thinks so, I think they need to hold a lot of workshops all around the country. First of all, they should select some universities that, you know, that can be role models, or I think that some universities where these kind of programs can be piloted, And once they're successful, then you can actually roll out. You can't expect, you know, every college in rural India also to roll out a 4 years liberal kind of program. That's simply not possible. So, you know, if you have a NIRF ranking or on whatever basis, I wouldn't like to actually, you know, kind of speak on that. But maybe some universities can be selected. This kind of program can be piloted. And then those universities can actually be master trainers, like, you know, the schemes where, you know, NAC has this scheme where they actually select universities to train other colleges and universities to, you know, bring in quality and be prepared for NAC accreditation. So something like that. Otherwise, it's not.
Quick follow-up question on that. So one of the, you know, disadvantages of the Indian system compared to, let's say, a system in any other, most other countries, is that there's no flexible entry and exit. So when you're looking at, you know, if I am working in industry, if I'm studying and I want to go out and do a job and come back and complete my studies, or if I'm a professor or someone, I want to go back and come back in, there is no flexibility here. And you know, many critics of the Indian system say that it is very rigid and unflexible. In your view, does the national, new education policy, like you termed it, the NEP 2020, does it actually address this issue of flexibility, of, you know, microcredits, of, stop, start, etc.? And if not, what needs to be done?
So, yes, of course, they have spoken about flexibility. They are talking about the academic credit bank and, a modular program. I mean, you know it better than me, you know, because you've worked in that area. So I think flexibility is the key. But again, as I said, you know, it's a mindset of or a culture of a country. You know, in our country, we don't have self-financed students. I mean, parents still finance the education of their children, at least at the undergraduate level. Now you see a lot of postgraduate, typically MBA students, who are self-financed, or, you know, but most of our student population is financed by their parents. And most parents are obviously working parents, and they want to finish the child's education in a given span of time till they can support their children. And therefore, you know, it has to also bring in a cultural change. I mean, now you see a lot of self-financed students at the postgraduate level. I don't think they were there even 5 years or 10 years ago. Now you see a lot of working professionals who leave their work jobs and come into MBA or, you know, other postgraduate programs. This culture was not there earlier. I'm sure this culture will come in, but it will take time. But of course, yes, flexibility must be given. I think programs need to be modular. Why should a program of a 3-year or a 4-year degree program not be split into, you know, a diploma and advanced diploma and so on and so forth? I mean, this is what I think you have promoted through your skill development, portfolio when you were there. And I think these are things that we need to bring in, because there is still a certain population that may not even afford, leave alone, you know, parents financing, but there could be a population that may not afford education, may not afford a 3-year degree program. So if someone wants to come to Symbiosis, now let's take examples of private universities where the fees are relatively high. Imagine if Symbiosis had this flexibility, and if I could give a program, maybe an advanced diploma in 2 years or a diploma in 1 year. And if a child comes and does this and gets employed, goes to the industry somewhere close by in Pune, and I can accept him coming back into the system and he gets a degree, I think that can be, I mean, nothing can be better than this. But yes, again, you know, it's the implementation which is going to be challenging.
Okay, so I let me just turn to this. Over the last few years, I think you've been leading the FICCI efforts in this. So if I were to look at the NEP 2020, so what of the FICCI recommendations got accepted, and what are we actually working on now currently to enable this to go forward?
You know, sometimes when we look at the national education policy, we feel, is it something that we created at FICCI? And, you know, I mean, that's too much to say. But honestly speaking, yes, we have, given reports to the ministry. In fact, we've had several interactions with Dr. Kasturi Rangan. I personally was involved in the stakeholder, meetings that were held specifically for internationalization and so on. So I think FICCI has played a major role. If you look at our 2030 report, the knowledge paper that we created, and if you really compare it with the education policy that has been rolled out, there is a lot of similarity. So I personally feel that this new education policy is something that is, you know, you feel that it is your own, it's your own creation. I think I told Dr. Kasturirangan this, that, you know, you created a policy where you've actually consulted more than 2.5 lakh people. But for each one of us, it feels as if there's something that I contributed to this. And I would definitely say that FICCI has played a major role in contributing to this policy, both in a formal and an informal way, because we've had interactions with Dr. Kasturirangan on several occasions.
You know, thank you for your leadership during that period. But since you got this lovely background of your international university in the brick and mortar building, given the fact of COVID and the disruptions that it brought in, how do you see it actually? What will be mainstream going forward? You know, because a lot of the stuff which we actually did during the COVID, so many school children came out. University kids were actually operating from home. You had open book examinations, you know, and faculty were actually doing a lot of work. So how do you, you know, see technology playing a role in the education system? And also, you know, what are the critical interventions that are required for online education and, you know, in the country? Because, you know, if I go back, and sorry for this long question, but if I go back, if you look at the top 10 open universities in the world in terms of enrollment, right, five were from India. I mean, there's no other such thing when the top, you know, 10, there are five from India. But when it comes to the brick and mortar and the other things, we don't even feature anywhere other than, of course, enrollment in terms of Pune University or something like that, the number of students. But how do you see this technology actually playing a role forward? And what do we need to do as a country, as people, to actually drive this and taking it forward?
I think of all the worst of things that have happened because of this pandemic, one good thing that has happened is in the education system, where a lot of technology was used and will continue to be used in years to come. See, every time we spoke about ICT in education, and we all as university administrators felt that our teachers should use more of technology, you know, than really face to face. But it never happened. But the moment we were struck by the pandemic, I think it was more of a reactive response to this, where there was no option but for the teachers to use technology, and they literally struggled. And I must give them all the credit to all teachers, at least in the Indian context, I would say, who really geared up so well to combat this and provide, you know, education through the use of technology during that period, which was very critical for students. It was March and April. It was year end. We were just finishing our, you know, academic calendar. Some of us were into examinations. So everything they managed beautifully. And I think the lockdown period of 2.5 months, at least in Pune city, I would say in Maharashtra, really helped us as university administrators to kind of train our faculty to the best use of technology and delivery. So those 2 months were really used for that. And I think now there's no looking back. The way teachers are so happy using technology through any platform and engaging with students, and students anyways were well versed with technology. So they are kind of not very happy, of course, undergoing those online lectures. Everybody wants to come to college. We keep getting mails from all the students and parents as to when we are going to open. So, of course, technology cannot replace face-to-face. Online education cannot replace conventional education, because there's a lot more than just, you know, imparting knowledge. I mean, a university setup is about building personalities. It's about peer learning. It's about being with your friends, you know, sitting in cafeterias and several other things, living in hostels together and enjoying that whole diversity in the university campuses. But yes, of course, I mean, when you don't have an option, then obviously you seek to such methods. But I think the new normal, or whatever the normal, is going to be blended education. Because now, you know, teachers have geared up, teachers have understood the importance of, you know, using technology, you know, for imparting lectures. And another good thing that has happened is integrating of some of the platforms like Coursera, edX and all. So somewhere internationalization has been a catalyst, I would say, for this kind of blended learning. I mean, today we have lectures being given through Coursera, because we signed up for the Coursera for campus. I mean, I'm just talking about Coursera, there are so many other platforms where you get the best of lectures now being imparted to your students. So when I talk about internationalization at home, that how do students who are not mobile or who cannot afford to go to a foreign country also experience internationalization? I think this is just the right way. So this blended education or online education has also helped, you know, this whole process of internationalization. And the way forward, Dilip, I think it would be blended education because students have got hooked up to that and so also faculty. And then it will be a great mix of, you know, on campus and, you know, also supporting it by using technology. I think it's also the administration, university administration that has geared up. I mean, we never, ever, got into this whole ERP and, you know, the way our administrators are using technology is quite commendable. So something that was really kind of a back burner has come to the forefront and we're all very happy about it.
My final question here really is, and we started with it. So how do you see India becoming a global destination for higher education? Has the policy adequately focused on it? What are the effective reform measures that they put in? Or do we need to do something more? You know, so far, if you take the number of students from India going overseas, you know, we're spending billions of dollars on educating our people overseas. Do you think that we can actually reverse this and, you know, education can replicate the IT story in India?
I think I can go for an hour actually on this topic, which is very, very close to my heart and I keep discussing about it. But yes, to be short, you very well know that there are just 47,000 foreign students in India and about more than 10 lakh Indian students studying abroad. Of course, now the picture could be different and, could be tweaked because there would be lesser number of foreign students traveling at least for the next 2 years. But be as it may, I think India is definitely geared up to be the education hub of, you know, this part of the world. And, now we can see some efforts, trickling efforts, of course, through EDSIL, the scholarships that they offer to students from almost 30 target countries that they've identified. And, fortunately, I've been associated with both EDSIL, Ministry of Education, and with their efforts, as well as, the SEPC, the Ministry of Commerce, which has the Services Export Promotion Council, where we are looking at education and driving education as one of the export services by the Ministry of Commerce. But, you know, Dilip, what I feel is that, you know, no ministry should work in isolation. I mean, if you look at any other country, whether it's Australia, New Zealand, obviously US and most European countries, they actually have this one common interministerial group which works together. And I think that has to be done in India because it is Ministry of External Affairs, Ministry of Commerce, Ministry of Education, and more importantly, Ministry of Home Affairs. Because all these ministries need to come together and drive this agenda of education. So we are trying to push it, and I'm very glad to let you know, and I'm sure you're aware that when Mr. Subramaniam was the secretary, MHRD, he formed a group called EQUIP, to enhance the quality in institutions across India, in which internationalization was one big group, and Amitabh Kant was chairing it. I was a member. And, so now it's being driven from Niti Aayog. I sit on SEPC, so now I know it's been driven by Ministry of Commerce. A Ministry of External Affairs wants to know how many foreign students are there in our country and how do we boost it up and what should Indian high commissions or Indian embassies across the world should do. So now we are seeing this new change, and I think we will see greater number of students. I mean, if COVID hadn't happened, we would have certainly seen more number of students in 2020 itself. But I'm sure by 2022, the pendulum is going to swing. This is one. Second is with the kind of universities and with this national education policy, and if by 2022 really our universities gear up, at least a handful of us, then there will be a reverse brain gain, or maybe what you can call it as students staying back to do their studies in India, because see, most of us have great collaborations with some of the best universities in the world. So why should a student go to the US and spend that kind of money, whereas he would probably get to spend a semester in a good university in the US or Europe while studying at Symbiosis or Manipal or BITS Pilani or any private university? Why private, even government universities? If you look at Pune University, they have a lot of collaborations and semester abroad programs. So I think now the times are going to change, and we hopefully won't lose those many foreign remittances, will not happen as what they are happening right now. I mean, I think the figure that we hear or read is about $4.6 billion that we lose out every year to hardly anything that comes in. But India has never looked at that the currency part or the commercialization part of of this whole process. But I think India's looked at education being a soft power, and I think we can do wonders. Definitely through the Afro-Asian belt, you know very well, West Asia, Africa, Southeast Asia are our catchment areas, Central Asia. I mean, you have so many students who want to come and study here because they feel they're culturally closer to us, Afghanistan. And now we see Indian government giving a lot of scholarships. So I'm sure it's going to happen, and India will soon be a destination. I've written papers on this, so I can, as I said, I can go on for many, many hours.
And then we also been actually playing a small role under your leadership under the Higher Education Summit, which we get a lot of reverse bias seller meets and all organized there. So Dr. Vidya, thank you for sharing your views on what you think about the new education policy, the whole thing of the community approach going forward, and also the opportunities for allowing greater flexibility for students, and then of course finally making India really a higher education hub for the world. Thank you for your leadership of the committee, and we look forward to taking this further and working with government and actually executing the NEP 2020.